people of God, good morning. Grace and peace to you from God our Creator and the Lord Jesus Christ. It is truly a joy to welcome you to Parkwood Presbyterian Church this morning. My name is Sarah Juist, I'm the pastor here, and it is so lovely to see you all on this beautiful, beautiful day. I do encourage everyone to grab the friendship register, the red notebook that's in the center chair in front of you. Pass that down the row and then send it back so you can see who you're sitting with and who's nearby. As we gather this morning, I do have a few announcements and reminders, as always. First things first, you may have noticed when you came in, you may not, that we have a brand new roof. How exciting! They started first thing on Monday morning, the team from Complete Roofing and Repair, and they were done and cleaned up and gone by the time I left at 3:15 on Tuesday. So it was an amazingly fast and efficient process, so thanks be to God for all of that. I wanted to point out a few things about worship today that are new or new-ish. So we will be celebrating the sacrament of communion, and absolutely everyone is welcome. So please participate today as you feel comfortable. We will also have a new addition to the prayer portion of our service. So after the prayers of the people and before the Lord's Prayer, I will leave about 20 seconds of silence for us to pray silently as you wish to. This is something that we're trying out for the worship committee to add some space for silence and prayer and reflection to our worship services. So I wanted to give you a heads up so that you don't think something is wrong when I go silent for 20 seconds in the middle of prayer. We also have a new to us hymn at the end of the service, number 852, When the Lord Redeems the Very Least. But, so it's unfamiliar words, but it is a very familiar tune. It's to the tune of I'll Fly Away, the spiritual, and so we're going to try that on for size this morning. Again, wanted to give you a heads up. And now you'll have I'll Fly Away stuck in your head for the next hour or so. You're welcome. We have a few exciting things going on this week coming up in the life of the church. The biggest one is our artisan market and collected treasure sale and jewelry sale all at once. So if you can, we encourage you to stick around after worship to help us rearrange this space to make space for that. And if you're not already volunteered for something on Saturday, we could use a few more folks to help out with the jewelry sale portion of the day. So anytime between 9 a.m. and 3 p.m., we could use a few folks to help us keep an eye on the jewelry and tabulate jewelry sales, etc. If you would like to know more or to volunteer, you can see Nancy. Where's Nancy? Nancy's in the back. So you can see Nancy, and she will get you all signed up. So the market, if you're not volunteering, the market is from 9 to 3 this Saturday. Bring your friends, shop. We have a ton of really wonderful things for you to choose from. There are some flyers on the back table if you'd like to take one and pass those out to friends and family. Also this week, the choir begins rehearsals with our music director, Karen Albert. So if you are a singer or a musician, you are most welcome to join them at 7 p.m. on Wednesday. No experience necessary, just show up and they will welcome you very, very warmly. So heads up, choir folks, the room will look a little different on Wednesday for rehearsal, but you knew that coming. Last but not least, in your bulletin, there is a flyer for the Peace and Global Witness offering. This is one of the four special offerings we take each year that goes to mission around the world with the Presbyterian Church USA. So you'll hear more about that in the coming weeks. We'll collect that on October 1st, but This is a great way to get involved with mission and peacemaking around the world with the Presbyterian Church. Okay, do we have any other announcements this morning? David?
Just a statement that, remember last week when we celebrated the kind of the passing of the ministry of the Roof Circle from Eastminster to Parkwood, and there was a wonderful group of ladies that were up front. You saw them in the Parkwood Press. One of those ladies was not named. That's Lynn Klug. She was here. She was in the press, but unnamed. So she's a part of that Roof Circle as well.
Absolutely. Thank you. Marie?
Thank you. Please join me in our confession and assurance. Jesus Christ overcame evil with good so that all people might be saved from sin. Then let us then confess our need for grace, confident of God's forgiveness. God of love, you ask us to love one another from the center of who we are. You tell us to bless one another. You encourage us to do good. But we have not listened to your words. Instead of loving, we have practiced hatred. Instead of blessing, we have perfected cursing. Instead of doing good, we have stopped hating you. Forgive us for giving up. Give us grace to try again and encouragement to make your ways our ways. We pray, we wait, and we hope. Amen.
Jesus came into the world, lived, died, and rose again for us and for our salvation.
The same Jesus asks us to take up our own crosses and follow him.
Because he has conquered sin and death,
we forever belong to God, forgiven and free. Thanks be to God.
O Holy Creator, you spoke of all creation into being. We ask that you keep speaking to us now. Speak to us as we read scripture, that we might hear your voice ringing loud and clear. Speak to us that we might hear and understand. Amen. Our first reading is from Romans chapter 12, verses 9 through 21. Let love be genuine. Hate what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal. Be ardent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in suffering. Persevere in prayer, contribute to the needs of the saints, extend hospitality to strangers. Bless those who persecute you, bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice, weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble in the sight of all. If it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave room for the wrath of God. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. No, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink. For by doing this, you will heap burning coals on their heads. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
If you were with us last week, you might remember that discipleship is a lifelong learning process. And sometimes that process involves being wrong out loud. This is one of those moments for the Apostle Peter, which comes right on the heels of his light bulb moment that we heard about last week, when he says to Jesus for the first time, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." You win some, you lose some. So this is Matthew chapter 16, verses 21 through 28. From that time on, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and undergo great suffering at the hands of the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed, and on the third day be raised. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, "God forbid, Lord, this must never happen to you." But he turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." Then Jesus told his disciples, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit them if they gain the whole world but forfeit their life? Or what will they give in return for their soul? For the Son of Man is to come with his angels in the glory of the Father, and then he will repay everyone for what has been done. Truly, I tell you, there are some standing here who will not taste death before they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. The word of the Lord. Peter understood that Jesus was the promised Messiah, but he did not yet understand that Jesus wasn't going to follow the path they thought he would or should take. For Jews in this era, the promised Messiah was a warrior king figure who would come to liberate the land and the people from Roman rule, and would sit on the throne of Israel to rule that earthly kingdom, just as King David had done, but even better. And of course, whomever had helped that Messiah along the way would have a special place in that kingdom, a place of honor, perhaps nobility, perhaps even some power. So when Jesus starts talking about being rejected by the religious leaders, suffering and dying, Peter understandably says, "Stop talking like that. That is not how this is supposed to work." "Don't worry," he says. "We'll defend you. We will fight with you." But ruling an earthly kingdom, fighting the Roman army for control over territory, that was never Jesus' goal. His kingdom, for now at least, is a spiritual one. So now that these disciples understand that Jesus is the Messiah, Jesus' next task is to reform their ideas of what a Messiah is and what a Messiah does, and what it means to be a disciple of that Messiah. After rebuking Peter, Jesus turns to the whole group of disciples, and I cannot overemphasize how utterly shocking and horrifying Jesus' next words would have been for them. "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me." Crucifixion was not a rare phenomenon. It was used in many empires across the known world for at least 6 centuries. As a form of capital punishment in the Roman Empire, it was generally reserved for those with no standing, no civil rights, slaves, pirates, political dissidents, and enemies. So at this point, for these listeners, the cross was not a marker of faith or the symbol of a suffering savior. The cross was a threat. It was a symbol of terror and a terrible, torturous death. Y'all, they would have thought we are absolutely out of our minds for wearing crosses as jewelry, or on clothes, or tattooing them on ourselves. So when Jesus says, "Take up your cross," they know he's not talking about the giving up chocolate for Lent kind of suffering. If they're going to walk this road and follow him, it will not lead them to power or prestige in this life. No one's getting a throne. There's no mansion, no title of nobility, or easy office job waiting for them in the king's palace in Jerusalem. Following Jesus will instead lead them into dangerous situations. Traveling far from their homes and their families, relying on the goodwill of others for support and shelter. And in the midst of all that, the very real, tangible, painful, cry out to God kind of suffering. And Jesus was right. Most of those disciples would be martyred in far-flung corners of the world, from India to Rome to Turkey and China. Following this Messiah, they will gain very little in terms of what we can measure, and they will lose a lot, up to and including their very lives. But Jesus then takes that question of gain and loss and flips it upside down. What does it profit someone to gain the whole world and lose their soul? The word that's alternately translated life and soul in this passage is psuche, and it refers to someone's internal life force, the breath of life, the intangible thing that animates every person. So, for the disciples and for us, following Jesus wholeheartedly and on purpose is an exercise in integrity. You can gain a lot of status, wealth, connections, power by pretending to be whoever or whatever someone else wants to hear or see. But if you do that, you will lose yourself, the very thing that makes you, you. The gospel does not demand that we seek out suffering for suffering's sake. You do not have to give up everything and go live in a hermitage in order to be a good disciple. The message here is simply that sometimes living into our faith and ideals is hard and not fun at all. One of the easiest everyday examples that I'm pretty sure every single one of us has run into at some point is the use of slurs and bias in everyday conversations. As someone who both believes and proclaims for a living that God truly loves and embraces all people and calls us to do the same, what do we do when we're in the middle of a conversation and someone casually drops something like the N-word, or calls a whole group of people ignorant or lazy or cheap, or insults someone else's life or culture? As much as I would like to say that I stop and encourage every single person I meet to take a step back and examine their choices and rein in their bias, sometimes that's a battle I don't want to fight. But I also know that if I go too long without confronting it, then folks will assume I agree with it. My integrity gets damaged, and in that relationship, I lose a little part of my true self and my true beliefs. God calls each of us to live as faithful followers. For the 12 and those who walked with Jesus, that meant taking this good news of a crucified and risen Savior to every corner of the known world, and enduring both the celebration and rejection of that message, and all that comes with it. For us, that means finding ways to live out our faith, our ideals, with true integrity. Being willing to accept that not everyone will love us for it. The easy examples are all around us. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and the American Civil Rights Movement. Dietrich Bonhoeffer and Corrie ten Boom, who resisted the Nazis. Nelson Mandela and Bishop Desmond Tutu, who fought for equality in South Africa. Each of them, in their own way, practiced what Paul would later preach and suffered for it. We heard these words from Romans: let love be genuine, hate what is evil, hold fast to what is good. Bless those who persecute you, bless them and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice, weep with those who weep. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. It's a lot easier to say than to do, right? But to love our neighbors, our friends, and our enemies, regardless of what they give us in return, is to trust in the goodness and the ultimate justice of God, who is at work reconciling all things. Friends, this is the good news. Jesus came into the world for us and for our salvation. He lived and healed and taught and loved, suffered and died. On the third day, he rose again to bring life and everlasting love and belonging to all people. All people. And we who follow him are called to do as he did. To live, to love, to teach, to hope, to liberate, and to serve. Even and especially when it's hard. Thanks be to God.
Amen. Amen.
I'll now invite us to rise as you're able for our next hymn. Today we all are called to be disciples. With God and with one another, and with all the saints, in every time and every place. And we come in hope, anticipating that great and glorious day when we will all gather at the table in Christ's kingdom. As we gather, let us pray. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord our God.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and grace.
Holy and right it is, and our joyful duty to give thanks to you at all times and in all places, O Lord, our Creator, almighty and everlasting God. You created heaven with all of its hosts and the earth with all of its plenty. You have given us life and being, and you preserve us by your providence. But you have shown us the fullness of your love in sending into the world your Son, Jesus, the Christ, the eternal Word made flesh for us and for our salvation. For the precious gift of this mighty Savior who has reconciled us to you, we praise and bless you, O God, with all the church on earth and with all the company of heaven. We worship and adore your glorious name, saying,
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory.
Most righteous God, we remember in this supper the perfect sacrifice offered once on the cross by our Lord Jesus Christ for the sin of the whole world. In the joy of his resurrection and in expectation of his coming again, we offer ourselves to you as holy and living sacrifices. Together, we proclaim the mystery of our faith.
Christ is alive. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
So send your Holy Spirit upon us, we pray, that the bread which we break and the cup which we bless may be to us our communion in the body and blood of Christ. Grant that, being joined together in him, we might attain to the unity of our faith and grow up in all things into Christ our Lord. Just as these grains have been gathered from many fields into one loaf, and these grapes from many hills into one cup, grant, O Lord, that your whole church might soon be gathered from the ends of the earth into your kingdom.
Even so, come, Lord Jesus.
On the same night that he was betrayed, Jesus sat at table with his disciples. There, he took bread. He blessed God for it, and he broke it. He gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body given for you." After they had eaten, he took the cup, blessed God for it, and poured it out, saying, "This cup is the new covenant poured out in my blood. As often as you do this, remember me." Friends, this is not my table. This is not Parkwood's table. This is not a Presbyterian table. This is Christ's table. And precisely because of that, absolutely everyone is welcome. So please participate as you feel comfortable today. A word of instruction. In a moment, the ushers will dismiss you by rows, starting with the back, and invite you to come forward down the center aisle, receive a piece of bread from me in the center, and then you can go to either table on either side, where one of the elders, servers, will place a cup in front of you on the table. We invite you to take the cup, partake, and leave it in the basket at the end. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. If you cannot come forward today, Dwight will come to you. I'll invite the servers forward. Thank you. Come, all things are now ready.
Thank you.
Christ has fed us in body and in spirit. Let us pray. God of grace, we give you thanks and praise for all of the ways that you call us and encourage us along the way. God, we pray that as you have fed us, that we might turn around and use this energy, this goodness, this gift for the good of others. We pray this in the name of Jesus, our Savior.
Our call to the offering. The Apostle Paul encourages us, do not lag in zeal, but be ardent in spirit. Serve the Lord in loving service to this loving Lord. We now return to God, to God a portion of the bounty God has provided.
Favorite Sunday morning traditions here at Parkwood is to have a sharing of joys and concerns where we can rejoice with those who rejoice and weep with those who weep. So what joys and concerns do we have to share this morning? Chuck?
You can see the joy I have and my family being here. It's helped me celebrate my 30th birthday. Times three.
Thanks be to God, indeed. What else?
prayers for the people who've suffered through the latest hurricane and the fact that many insurance companies are not covering now natural disasters.
Absolutely. Prayers for those who have endured this latest hurricane and for those who no longer have insurance that will cover natural disasters because the companies are deciding not to cover it. James.
I have begun round 4 of chemotherapy. They have upped the dosage of one of the medicines, and the side effects from that are noticeable.
Yeah, so Jay has begun round 4 of chemo, and they've changed the dosage, upped the dosage on one of the meds, and that has brought some more noticeable side effects. So we will continue to pray for relief and for healing. Thank you. Marie?
We've been praying for my cousin John with his cancer diagnosis and his chemo. He's doing okay. He says the hardest part is the mental games.
Absolutely.
So he still needs prayers for his mental and emotional.
Absolutely. For Marie's cousin John, who has a somewhat recent cancer diagnosis and is going through chemo, and for continued strength in the midst of all that. Thank you. Any others? All right. Nancy.
It has been amazing to watch the number of people who have put in so many hours as we get into the Artisan Market Coffee Treasures jewelry sale. It's been a huge blessing just to watch all the people come forward with their talents, their time, their energy. And so I just pray as we go into Saturday that we can look forward to God just blessing us with laughter and joy and great sales for the benefit of the church and its investment.
Absolutely. Amen. Thanks be to God for all of the people and time and talent and energy that has gone into this. I don't know if you all know this, but there's a committee that's been working behind the scenes for well over 6 months now to make all of this happen. And so thanks be to God for all of those people and for all of you in the midst of this. Okay. Let's go to God in prayer together. God of hope, we come to you with hearts that are full. Hearts that are full of joy and celebration, worry and need, all mixed up together. God, we thank you and praise you for Chuck, for his birthday celebration this weekend, for all of his family that has come from far and wide to celebrate with him and be with him today. God, we pray that you would help them enjoy their celebrations and keep them safe as they travel to wherever home may be. We also thank you for all of the faithful people, all of the time and talent and treasure that has gone into this Artisan Market Collected Treasures Vintage Jewelry Sale. God, we pray that you would bless us this weekend with all good things. With laughter and joy, with people finding exactly what they need at the right moment. Lord, we also lift up what weighs heavy on our hearts. We pray for those who are grieving, who are ill, who are recovering, who are anticipating. Lord, we lift up Jay as he begins round 4 of chemo and endures these new and not fun side effects. God, we pray that you would give him the strength and endurance to get through all of this and to come out the other side healthy and well and with all that he needs. We pray the same for John as he too endures treatment God, we pray that you would give him strength and courage and patience as he does what needs to be done. We pray too for all those who are victims of natural disasters, especially those who are suffering from the latest hurricane in the Gulf Coast and Florida. God, we pray that you would help us to help them. We pray that you would raise up support even as insurance companies flee. We pray that you would strengthen us and help us meet needs as they arise. We lift all of this up to you, trusting in your goodness as we pray silently. And our voices together in the prayer that you taught us, saying,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on the earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Number 852, When the Lord Redeems the Very Least.
Thank you.
love,
we seek to grow in love for God and neighbor.
This love is the work of our hearts, to care and be cared for,
of our souls to know and be known,
of our minds to learn and to teach,
and our strength to do justice and so on.
Friends, as you go, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his face to you and give you